Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you again today. Welcome to Worship and the Word with us here at Church of the True Vine. I pray that God would bless you today as we spend this time together. We are living in momentous days at the moment. We have seen not only a change of government in the United Kingdom, but within 2 days of the new Prime Minister being appointed, we have been saddened by the death of our dear Queen Elizabeth II. Many people around the world are finding themselves shaken by events, shaken by circumstances, and somehow that fixed point of Her Majesty gave comfort, and we give thanks to God for everything that He achieved through her life and through her reign. And we pray for King Charles III as he takes up the mantle of King of the United Kingdom, Great Britain and the Commonwealth. Please join with us later as we pray for him, as we pray for the new government with Liz Truss. Whatever your political persuasions, we are commanded in Scripture to pray for those in authority. So please join with us as we pray not only for King Charles, but also for our new Prime Minister, Liz Truss. These are days when a lot of people are unsettled, and so I want to read Psalm 121, which is a psalm I personally have taken great comfort from in unsettling times. It says this: I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. We have a God who is mighty. We have a God who is just. We have a God who is loving. And we can place our trust in him no matter what is going on in the world. We have a God in whom we can trust. We're going to be worshiping him today. We're going to be worshiping God who so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Our God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the Lord. He changes not. That is a great place of trust for us to be in. We're also going to be praying, continuing to pray regarding this situation, this war in Ukraine. Obviously praying for King Charles and for the new government, but also continuing to pray for Christians around the world who are persecuted for their faith. And this week we're praying for Christians in Niger. I'm just very briefly going to read to you what the World Watch List booklet has to say about the nation of Niger. Once a country known for cross-religious harmony, Niger has re-entered the top 50 of the World Watch List, reflecting how pressure is increasing on Christians in this Muslim-majority nation. Most of the population regard Islam as part of their ethnicity. If you are a Nigerien, you are a Muslim. Believers from Muslim backgrounds are most vulnerable to persecution and often come under intense pressure from their families and communities to renounce their faith. Violent attacks are also increasing. So please join with us as we pray for our brothers and sisters in Niger later on. But as I say, we have a great, we have a mighty God, the maker of heaven and earth, of all things seen and unseen. And we're going to turn our attention now simply to giving him glory and giving him praise, singing that great, great old hymn, How Great Thou Art. God bless you as we worship the Lord together today.
My God, when my inawesome wonder. I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou
art. Lord, we thank you that in your word you call us to come and bring our requests, our prayers, our petitions before you. And Lord, I just thank you that you are a God who listens. You are a God who wishes to commune, that you are living, that you are active with your people. And that, Lord, you answer our prayers and our petitions. Lord, we come to you this morning as the King of Kings, as the Lord of Lords, that you are God Almighty, that you are the creator of heaven and earth. Lord, we thank you for what you have done. We give you praise, we give you glory. Hallelujah, glory to your name. Lord, you tell us to pray for those who are in authority over us. And Lord, we pray particularly right now for our royal family. Lord, we thank you for the life of our Queen, Queen Elizabeth II. We thank you, Lord, for her duty, her sense of duty, that, Lord, she served her people, but Lord, also, she served you as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords as well. Lord, it says in your word that you comfort all that mourn. And we pray that her family, and not just her family, but that all those who are grieving, who are mourning for her right now, you will comfort them with your love. And we pray particularly for Charles, King Charles, as he takes over that honour of serving this country as king, and the immense sense of duty that is involved with that. We pray for him, Lord. We pray that you will grant him wisdom, you will grant him strength, that, Lord, he may call upon you as he comes into his kingship. We pray for that family, Lord, and that where there have been rifts, that, Lord, you will bring your balm of peace. You will bring your balm of reconciliation amongst that family right now in the name of Jesus. And, Lord, too, we pray for our government, our newly appointed Prime Minister. Lord, we pray for wisdom for Liz Truss. Whatever political persuasion we may be, Lord, you call us to pray for those who are in authority. And so we pray for our government right now in this time of change, this unprecedented time of change, that, Lord, we have a new king, we have a new monarch and new prime minister within 2 days of each other. Lord, unprecedented in our time of history, but Lord, we know that we can depend on you. We know that you are a rock on which we can build our lives. And I just ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you will give wisdom, you will give strength, you will give guidance to all those who govern, to all those who are making laws, making statutes. Lord, will you preside, and by your Holy Spirit, will you direct the course? We ask this in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray too for the country of Ukraine, where they have gone through such an upheaval in their land over the last few months as they have been engaged in this war. Lord, we pray for your peace in that land. Lord, it's unfathomable. All those people who have been uprooted from their lives, their normal day-to-day lives, those who have lost loved ones. Lord, we pray again that you will comfort those who are mourning for lost ones at this time, but also for those who've been uprooted from their homes, uprooted from their daily lives. Lord, will you bring peace? Will you bring your love? Will you bring your comfort to them? And we ask for peace and a quick resolution to this war. And Lord, we too pray for our brothers and sisters in the country of Niger. Lord, we thank you for each and every one of them. And Lord, we pray that those Islamic extremists in the land, that, Lord, you will intervene in their lives, and that, Lord, there will be a decrease in those extremists, that, Lord, as once before, people of different faiths could live in peace with one another. Lord, will you enable that in the land? Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ who have experienced trauma as a result of their faith. Lord, will you bring healing? Will you bring comfort to them? Will you strengthen them? Will you embolden them? Will you enable them to know that you are with them, that you promise never to leave them nor forsake them. May they know and experience your presence with them right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for the work of Open Doors in that land, that, Lord, they may continue with their training programs to encourage believers, to give knowledge to believers, to teach those believers to stand for their faith. Lord, I pray also that you will bring opportunity across their path, that, Lord, they may share with wisdom the love that Jesus has, the good news of Jesus Christ in that land. Oh, Heavenly Father, again, we just give you glory and honor and praise this morning and say we love you, but thank you, Lord, that we love you because you loved us first, that your love continues, is never ending. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name, Lord. Amen.
I'm reading today from the first book of Samuel, chapter 30, beginning at verse 1. Now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, attacked Ziklag, and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire, and their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. Just try and put yourselves in the shoes of David here. What an appalling situation he finds himself in. David and his men have returned to their homes, and they've discovered that the place where they lived has been invaded. Their homes have been burnt down. All of their possessions are gone. They've been looted. All of their treasures are gone. Everything they hold dear is gone, including their wives, their sons, and their daughters. Everything is gone. Everything. There is nothing left. And David and his men weep until they no longer have the strength to weep anymore. They're all cried out. There's nothing left. They are emotionally drained. They are completely spent. Physically spent, emotionally spent, mentally spent. Everything has come to an end. It's like the world has just caved in around them. There's nothing left of what they hold dear. And then these men turn on David and they threaten to stone him. This is David, the one who they have fought alongside. The ones who David would have regarded as his friends, his brothers in arms, his companions, are now threatening to stone him because their grief is so great, because their anguish is so extreme, and they are threatening to stone David. Those who David trusted have turned on him, and they're saying, "You are no longer fit to live because of the situation we now find ourselves in." Have you ever been in a situation where everything just seemed completely dark? There's no way out. There's no way through. You can't see how you're going to pay these bills. You can't see how you're going to get free of this sickness. Friends have turned against you. People that you've known for years are now blacking your name. They're now saying terrible things to you and about you. Everything has just gone wrong. It seems like there's nothing that can possibly go right. You know, in those situations, it's so easy just to cave in and say, "I deserve nothing. I deserve to be stoned." You could almost hear David saying, "You know what, guys? You're right. I've led you, but look where it's brought us. I deserve to be stoned. I don't deserve to live. Everything's bad. Everything's awful. And it's all my fault." You know, so many people are struggling with depression and oppression because things have gone wrong and all they can think is my fault. For some people, it's too much. And those people end up taking their own lives. That is a tragedy, a terrible, terrible tragedy. What do you do when things go horribly, horribly wrong? When you feel as though there is nothing you can do? What we see here is David's response. It says in verse 6, but David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. This is something that David had to do on many occasions in his life. Just turn to Psalm 3, where David says this. This is when David is having to run and hide from his own son, who is trying to kill him and take the throne. David says this, Lord, how they have increased who trouble me. Many are they who rise up against me. Many are they who say of me, there is no help for him in God. Again, David finds himself in a situation where there is no way out. There is, Absalom has a lot of support, and David is having to flee for his own life from his own son. Many are they who say of me, there is no help for him in God. People's opinions are not just, David, you've blown it. It's saying, David, you're not even going to get any help from God. Just give up. That's what the voices in David's head would be saying. Just give up. Just give in to despair. Just end it all right now. And yet, David responds by saying in Psalm 3, verse 3, but you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, and the one who lifts up my head. We see David there in the middle of that appalling situation, turning his attention to the God who has saved him in the past, turning his attention to the God who has promised to be with him, turning his attention to God in his might, in his power, in his love, in his mercy, in his grace. He gets his attention onto God. Whatever situation you find yourself in, if you can get your attention onto God, then you will begin to find a way through. In Psalm 13, again, David is saying, how long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long shall I have counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart daily? How long will my enemy be exalted over me? And yet, just a few verses later in verse 5, he says, but. The but is so important. David says here, but I have trusted in your mercy. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. What you see here, the situation hasn't changed. David still has enemies. David still has problems. David still has situations he's got to deal with. And yet, there is that but God. But God. But God. God, I'm not ignoring the truth of what is going on here. I'm not just denying the facts. I'm not denying that I'm sick. I'm not denying that the bills need to be paid. I'm not denying that there are problems in the family. I'm not denying any of those things. But I place my trust in you. I place my trust in God. You are my hope. You are my shield. You are my support. You are the one who has promised never to abandon me. You are the one who has made promises that you will keep forever. Malachi chapter 3 and verse 6, God says, I am the Lord. I do not change. Listen, your circumstances might change. Your circumstances might be terrible. Your circumstances may have gone from wonderful to appalling even in a day. But God does not change. God does not change. His word does not change. Heaven and earth will pass away, God says, but my word will never pass away. The word of the Lord stands forever. That means if God has said it, you can depend upon it. Whatever your situation, whatever your circumstance, David encouraged himself. He strengthened himself in the Lord. How? By getting his eyes onto God. David wasn't saying, well, I don't believe they're trying to stone me. I don't believe that things have gone wrong. I'm just going to push that out and I'm just going to, you know, be airy-fairy and trust in God and everything will be okay. I'll just cross everything and it'll be all right. No, David faces the fact that the situation is bad. David faces the fact that his home has been burned. David faces the fact that the homes of his men have been burned. David faces the fact that their wives and their sons and their daughters have been taken from them. David faces the fact that his men are about to stone him. But he faces it with the truth of who God is. He faces it with the truth that he is somebody who has a covenant with God. You know, when David faced Goliath, he didn't say, oh, well, he's not that big, really. No, if I just squint a bit, then he doesn't look so big. I can imagine that he's smaller than he is. No, he doesn't do that. David goes out. He knows how big Goliath is. He knows that Goliath is 9 feet tall and strong and fierce. He knows that Goliath has been a warrior from his youth. But he faces him with the fact that David belongs to God and Goliath doesn't. David says, you come at me with spear and sword and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord of hosts. He knows that God is with him. And that is what he faces the fact with. He faces the fact with the truth. Abraham knew the fact that his body was old. He was old. His wife was old. She'd been barren for years anyway. But God had promised that from Abraham's loins would come a son of promise, a son who was impossible to be born, naturally speaking, but God had promised him. Abraham faced that fact of his age and Sarai's barrenness with the truth that God had made a promise. When we come into situations, and I'm being perfectly honest here, we all have situations in our lives when it can overwhelm us, when we are all cried out, when we don't know how it's going to work out, we can't see a way through, and it's so easy just to focus on how appalling the situation is. And I'm not making light of that. I've been in those situations. I'm in one of those situations at the moment where it's difficult, and yet I keep my trust, I keep my hope in the Lord. And I remember for one thing that actually the situation that I'm facing, the situations that I'm dealing with on a day-to-day basis are nothing compared to what men of God have faced in the past. Just turn to 2 Corinthians and chapter 5, where the Apostle Paul speaks about the cost of being an apostle. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beg your pardon, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning at verse 8, Paul writes this: we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So then death is working in us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Paul has faced appalling situations. He's been shipwrecked, stoned, beaten, imprisoned, flogged, you name it. Pretty much Paul has had it done to him. And yet he says, our light and momentary troubles. Why? Because his eye is not on what he is enduring. He doesn't deny those things are happening. He's not going around saying, no, I'm not in pain from that beating. He's not saying that. He's saying, compared to the weight of glory which awaits, that is nothing. And I'm going to stay true to Jesus. I'm keeping my eye on him. I'm staying true to the mission that he has called me to. Listen, we all go through situations where it can seem as though the end of the world has arrived. What are we going to do in those situations? David strengthened himself in the Lord. And because he found strength in the Lord, then he was able to rally his men. They were able to pursue those who had taken their wives and their sons and their daughters captive. And they were able to defeat them and bring back those who had been taken from them. When we set our eyes on God in the middle of difficulties, we find strength to deal with those difficulties. We find the strength, we find the purpose, we find the way of doing those things. It's no help to sit in a slough of despair and despondency. I know, I've been there. It's no help. But when you fix your eyes on Jesus, when you fix your eyes on the faithfulness of God, when you fix your eyes on the promises of God, when you fix your eyes on the salvation that Jesus gives, when you fix your eyes on the things of the kingdom of heaven, suddenly our troubles become light and momentary troubles in our mind, because there is a weight of glory that awaits us, and that causes strength to come in our hearts. Whatever you're going through today, some of you may genuinely be feeling there is no way forward. Some of you may even be considering bringing things to an end, taking your own life. Let me say to you today, there is hope for you in God. There is hope for you in Christ Jesus. Whatever you're going through, the promises of God stand forever. God is the one who is a husband to the widow. God is the one who is a father to the fatherless. God is the one who sets the lonely in families. God is the one who promises, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. God is the one who promises that by his stripes you are healed. God is the one who promises through his servant, my God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. There is hope for you. There is hope for you. I urge you today, stop looking at how black the situation is, how awful the situation is. Stop looking at that. I'm not saying deny it. But get your eyes onto something higher. Get your eyes onto Jesus, the one who died for you. Get your eyes onto God, the one who withhold no good thing from you. He didn't withhold his only begotten son. There is no good thing that he will withhold from you if you will place your trust in him. Turn your eyes to Jesus. Turn your eyes to Jesus. And you will begin to find that faith rising in your heart. That faith might be as small as a mustard seed. It might be little faith. But Jesus said, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can speak to this mountain and say, be thou cast into the sea, and it will be removed. The promise of God stands forever. Strengthen yourself in the Lord. Stop trying to work things out. Stop trying to think, how am I going to get through this? Place your trust in God, because he is the one who makes a way where there is no other way. He is the one who gives strength to the weary. He is the one who guides you through the valley of the shadow of death. He is the one who restores your soul. He is the one who leads you beside quiet waters, who leads you to green pastures. So place your trust in him. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will bring you today. I just want to pray for you right now. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I bring anyone who is watching this, who is struggling today, who really is at the end of everything today. Lord, I pray that you would bring comfort to their soul, comfort to their heart. You would bring strength into their life, that you would give them wisdom to deal with the situation they face. You would supply every need that they have. You would heal their sickness. You would heal their family's sickness. You would sort out the issues in their family. Lord, I pray that you would move in the lives of anyone who is watching this, who is struggling. Lord, I pray that you would enable them to find strength in you. And I thank you, Lord, that every promise that you have made finds its yes and its amen in Christ Jesus. Lord, show them your promise for their situation. Give them something to cling to. Give them something to hold on to, something that will cause that strength and that faith to rise up in their hearts so that they will come through knowing that God has done it. I pray for them today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you today. God bless you. If you're struggling, we're here to pray with you, to help you in whatever way that we can. Simply fix your eyes on Jesus. Strengthen yourself in the Lord. If you need help with that, then please get in touch and we will do what we can to fix your eyes on the one who can help you through and bring you out of these circumstances. If you're anywhere in the Clevedon area, then please come and meet with us at the community centre on Prince's Road. We meet there at 10:30 every Sunday morning. If you're not in Clevedon, then please get in touch through email. The details will be on the screen in just a moment, and they'll be in the content part underneath this screen. We're back again on YouTube at the same time next week. That's 10 a.m. UK time. So until then, may God bless you. May God keep you. May God make his face to shine upon you. May God lift up his countenance toward you. May God be gracious to you and give you peace. God bless you. Bye-bye.